here's a preview. The song is called Stronger. The composer and the singer, Gary Barlow. To take that. That's cruel out there, you think? Or
been paid to scream
been
like
paid
that.
To scream. What's it been like carving a career after Take That? Has it been is it some blessing being with the group or in this situation? Or
I think
or
it
what?
Was great being with the group to start off because I don't know, I think there's so many things that can sidetrack you from what you're actually meant to do. And as a group, with the support of four other people, I think we all kept level-headed.
But that kind of adulation that's, mm-hmm. that you got when you walked out there and had all these girls shrieking and screaming. I mean, even worse than tonight. but, I mean, was it bound to sort of have an effect on you, isn't it? I mean, did it turn your head? Did it make you giddy? Did it make you sexy? What was it like?
All those things.
All those things.
it was great. It still is great. You know, how can you ever say you don't like it? Because yes. I think you always want people to like what you do. And, you know, when I get an applause or whatever, it's great. Because, I started in the clubs in England, It was lucky to be listened to, never mind getting applause.
The clubs was a tough school for you to learn in, wasn't it? I mean, you started doing that at a very early age, didn't you?
I was about 11 when I got my first job.
Really?
As a piano player. And then when I was about 16, I was starting to sing by then. But it was great because there's no, you know, recording vocals for weeks on end. It's one live performance.
Yes.
And, you know, that really taught me everything I knew. And like I say, with the audiences and things, it's a great way to learn.
You'd play some rough places, I guess.
Yeah. Played Barnsley.
You played Barnsley? Oh, that's a good one. But, And of course, there's something to that. I think there's something strangely noble about those entertainers as well, don't you? I mean, we could all have a laugh at them and bad comics and that sort of thing. But, you know, it takes some bottle to get up there night and day in, day out.
I used to hate the comedians, and not hate them. I used to hate it when they used to die. And this one night we were in a club, and this comedian went on, nobody listened to him all night. And he come off after about 20 minutes, and it was... All of a sudden, there was silence. We were in the dressing room, but we could hear silence. And he went, listen, the bingo's on, now there's silence. So he run out onto the stage, pulled his pants down, and was doing this to everybody. Now you'll be quiet. And they were doing a minute's silence for someone who died the week before.
Oh, dear, so, we shouldn't laugh, should we?
No, we shouldn't laugh, I really laughed.
Yeah, but as you said, you're going to survive that. Then you learn something, don't you? You're forged, definitely. In a sense, yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, and you went from there into the well, in fact, you went through quite a bit of rejection before you actually got... there was a lovely story in research that I want you to tell about going to see Elton John's publishing company with your demo disc.
That's right. I had quite a few good songs on this tape, like a million love songs, songs that were hits later on. And it was at Zomba Publishing, which is Elton John's publishing company, and this guy sat in the office, and he did the old trick where he turns his back on you, so you can't see whether he's tapping his foot, he's smiling or whatever. Anyway, he played the whole six songs. I'd never got that far before. He played the whole six, this is it, I'm going to get a publishing deal. And he turned round, picked the tape out of the recorder, opened the window and threw it out. So I thought, I don't think I'll be getting a deal here then.
A terrible thing to do. Yeah.
I told Elton actually later on.
Yeah, he's been very supportive, Elton, hasn't he?
He's been lovely to me.
He's a good man. Yeah. Now, what about going into that huge success that you had? I suppose it would change your life overnight, wouldn't it? I mean, all sorts of things would start happening to you that never happened to you before. Travel and stuff like that.
I think, definitely, because I know that all five of us, we hadn't actually been out of England when we joined the group. We were all kind of 19, and we'd been to France with the school and stuff, but we'd never actually been abroad. And I remember one of our first trips was Japan. Now, if there's one country that's their kind of whole religious, the way of life, everything, it's completely removed from the way we live.
Of course, it's open, yes.
And we went there a lot. In fact, I actually had a girlfriend there for about 6 months in Japan. And she really wanted me to meet her family. And I was a bit nervous about it because they didn't speak English at all, none of them. And anyhow, we flew in from England and I went straight from the airport to her house. She met me at the door. And the dad comes over and gives me his business card. So I go, nice, lovely. Put it in the back bin. And everyone went, and she said, don't put it in your back pocket, it's like sitting on his pride. So it went in the top. Beauty, all right. So that was great. And next minute, they said, we're going through to have some dinner. She said, he didn't say that. So everyone starts taking their shoes off, and I've just been on a 15-hour flight. I've come 3 hours from the airport. I thought this will be interesting. It was like Parmesan cheese. It was awful, believe me. We sat down for dinner. You know the way they have those low tables and they kind of sit like this? I can't, I'm not very supple, and if I sat with my legs crossed, I'd fall backwards. So I was like on my side like this. And I thought, I couldn't eat my dinner, but it was going down sideways, my dinner was. So I kind of like, I thought, I'd just go to the toilet, and I put my chopsticks in the bowl of rice, and everyone went, because that means death. I never saw her again. That was kind of it after that. But, I mean, just a cultural shock. Yes. For someone like me.
Yeah, yeah.
And I learned quickly.
As you said, it's a totally different society. It's like another world. And yeah. It's like being on Mars, isn't it?
Definitely.
What about, again, the other thing surrounding it, we touched on earlier on, about the sort of hero worship. I mean, I asked Jerry Halliwell this, what must it be like to go in a shop and see yourself as a doll?
I'd seen kind of the drawing, but I'd never actually seen one, so... It was Saturday afternoon, so I went off into Chester with a bit of a cap on, some glasses. I was in the middle of Toy and Hobby checking out the dolls. And I couldn't find my doll anywhere. I was thinking, I've sold out in here. There's hundreds of the others and I've sold out. Lovely. So I went to the desk and I said, have you got any Guy Barlow dolls in here? And she says, no, you've got to collect Howard, Mark, Jason and Robbie and you send the coupon off and get Gary for free.
Of course, I mean, you're always sort of shunted on one side, right, in a sense. I mean, you were the talented, the writer and the behind
the... I liked that, though. I liked it.
Did you?
I'm not really... I don't really qualify, I don't think, as kind of a superstar. I mean, kind of... No, what I mean is by this is that I couldn't fill the Sun for 6 months with stories about my life. I don't live my life like that. I very much differentiate work and being private, which is why I still live up north, really. And that's why, you know, I see superstars and I think, well, they're actually welcome to that, because I don't think I would actually really want it. Because I'd hate to be written about in such a way of all the time, he's having a divorce now, he's having kids, and I'd hate that. I really need my own space.
It's almost as if, isn't it, that some people sort of seek that kind of, that notoriety.
Some people love it, though, and that's great.
They complain about it, but they do nothing to prevent it.
That's right.
You know, it's how dare they write about me falling down a nightclub. Well, of course you fell down a nightclub. That's the answer.
And I'm kind of like... You know, I don't hang out with the drug scene and stuff like that. I'm quite a clean living person, and I think that, you know, I think that whole scene's a different ball game. I don't get involved in it at all. And like I say, I kind of get on with my job. I have a private life, and that's really great for me.
So it saves... I'm not going at Caroline, but it saves you going into the Priory, doesn't it?
It does, yeah.
No, I'm not
at all.
I mean, I don't get it though. I don't get the whole drugs thing. I mean, like, the coolness of... I mean, this is the day and age of the coolness of cocaine, you know. So cool, I really want to take a drug that makes me penis small, drains me bank balance, gives me a nosebleed. You know, it's kind of like, I don't get it.
Yes. No, you're right. It is glamorised, isn't it? You see, you know, this sort of heroin chic and all that nonsense, and it makes you angry, doesn't it? Because there's nothing glamorous about it at all. It's
definitely
awful.
Definitely not.
It's dreadful. It's an interesting point you made there, actually, which, I mean, all of you are like this. I mean, you all came from up north. Well, Caroline, you're down here now, I know, but you much prefer to be in Manchester. But you've all actually got your tap roots up there, haven't you? I mean, and for the same reason, do you feel that you've got a greater hold on reality in us up there?
Yeah, I mean, I like it in Sheffield. People
do you still live there?
Yeah, I still live in Sheffield. I was born and raised there, so, I mean, people say you've accumulated all this wealth. Now, why don't you move to London or buy different places? I'll buy different places, but I don't want to move out of Sheffield. It's where I'm from. The people are down to earth there. I like the
You're
place.
Happy there?
I'm happy, yeah. My parents are there, the whole of my family, and my friends are there, you know.
Mind you, I have to say that I've not seen too many people in Sheffield and Naz with the flash jewellery like that on. I mean, let's say.
I'd like to buy my.
They've got a camera. Let's have a look at this. Caroline was looking at this when Gary was singing.
That's great.
Is that all?
Well, I like to spoil myself now and again after the fight, you know, after certain fights. And so, I've trained really hard from the age of seven.
And there's watches down.
But, and I think I'll continue. The one thing that I'm missing at the moment is still that. What me and you talked about, Michael, is that McLaren F1. So
beauty.
The McLaren F1.
That's a beautiful looking car.
You need one.
Definitely.
It's essential.
Have you got a McLaren?
No. He needs one.
Have you seen it? this is a Formula One racing car.
It's a beautiful car. I mean, you're sat in the middle for starters. Yeah. I mean, you can, to your family or whoever sat beside you.
Yeah.
It's a great feeling. Yeah.
Are you going to get one?
Oh, definitely. Time will tell, as I say.
Yeah. Okay. Now, what about you're going on the road shortly, and you're promoting or will later on promote your record and that sort of thing?
Yeah, the record's going to be out just before the summer, I think. Mm. We were due to go on tour in April, but it's been put back. So sorry, everybody. I'm so sorry about that. I want to play the new album and stuff on it, and we're just a couple of songs short at the moment. Mm-hmm. So we're going to be going out at the end of the year. So I'm looking forward to that. I'll have to make it even more special when we go out.
So what's the ambition to be? I mean, you've always said that you're this middle-of-the-road entertainer, basically. That's what you like to think of yourself of, isn't it, basically?
Yeah, like I say, I always write music that's kind of pop music. It's kind of unoffensive. You know, that's the kind of music I like to make. If I was to try and be anything else, I wouldn't be being me.
Oh, Gary, you can't be that nice.
Go on, pretend he is.
Go on. Get a move on, I'm going for dinner.
Do you think he's got a secret somewhere?
I think, yeah.
You think
definitely,
so, do you?
Yeah.
In the way, in this estate, he's got a pinch.
Purer than pure, that's the way you paint yourself in now.
No, do you know what? Everyone says, oh, the nice guy and all this. So they don't really know about me because, like I say, I don't advertise my private life. I like a drink, I like to do things, whatever. People never hear about them. I don't like advertising. Things that people are going to write about in a bad way.
Yeah.
And I suppose that's how it's come about. I got out of that pretty well, didn't I?
Yeah!
Well, I much enjoyed talking to all of you, actually.
Thank you.
It was nice to you, and I enjoyed it very much indeed. I wish you all of you, in your different ways, every success. And Gary Barlow, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
My thanks then to Gary Barlow, to Prince Nassim and Caroline Ahern. Next week, my guests are comedian and actor Alan Davis, politician and national treasure Mo Mollam, and film star and sex symbol Warren Beatty. Oh, there's some older people in the audience, are there? Until then, from all of us here, a very good night. Good night.